morning, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us for the LNG Leadership Week Masterclass on Emotional Intelligence. Why and how is it essential for leaders? I'm Shati from People Matters and will be your host for today's Masterclass session and will take you through today's agenda. First of all, I would like to give you a brief on the LNG Leadership Week. LNG Leadership League is an initiative which is specially designed for the LNG leaders, helping them take talent management to the next level. This league is a combination of a bunch of activities like newsletters, masterclasses, learning week, coffee events, full day conference, and awards. Just to give you a brief on today's masterclass, this masterclass will focus on emotional intelligence. Why and how it is essential for leaders. Leaders are looked up by everybody, not just for what they do in their capacity as a leader, but also how they emotionally connect with people. Strong emotional intelligence is a prerequisite of a great leader. Research has established that emotional intelligence is the prerequisite of leadership. This becomes clearer when one understands emotional intelligence in greater depth and explores the components of emotional intelligence like self-esteem, self-awareness, emotional self-awareness, self-management, integrity, etc. In this seminar, we will be answering the following questions on emotional intelligence. What is emotional intelligence? Why and how emotional intelligence is essential for all of us and especially for leaders? How can emotional intelligence be a motivator to be a great leader? To present the session, we have the privilege of having with us Dr. S. Swaminathan. Dr. S. Swaminathan is an independent consultant and a visiting faculty at Great Lakes Institute of Management. His excellent facilitation skills and experience in conducting management development programs have helped organizations in enabling teams, leaders, and realize their potential. A partial list of his clients includes NET, K-Micro, Orchid Pharmaceuticals, EPAC, GA, TVS, Vetco, Hyundai, and many more. The sponsors for today's webinar for helping us make this program possible are Center for Creative Leadership, Pearson Talent Lens, Computer Systems for Skills of Company, Great Lakes Institute of Management, and Wilson Learning. We have saved time for you to ask your questions at the end of the masterclass. For those watching the live masterclass, you can submit your questions at any time during the presentation through the Q&A section. We will try to respond to as many questions as time allows. So without any further delay, I am going to hand over the microphone to Dr. Swami to start the exciting session. Welcome, Doctor, and over to you.
Hi, Sashi. Can you hear me?
Yes, Dr. Vian. You can start your presentation.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I don't know how many of you are out there, and I hope all of you are able to hear me. So I'm assuming that you will hear me. Sashi, could you alert me when we have the last 5 minutes so I know when to wrap up the session, okay?
Sure, Doctor.
Okay. Now, okay, am I clear and audible, Sashi?
Yes, yes, very clear.
Okay. Now, the topic today for our discussion or presentation is why is emotional intelligence essential for leaders? Now, so what I have done is I have made the presentation in two parts. In the first part, we will talk about what is emotional intelligence. I know most of you out there would be having some idea of what emotional intelligence is, but for the others, let's just quickly run through what emotional intelligence is, and then we will take this forward. We will then talk about leadership, then we will talk about the relevance of EI for leaders. How do I move the slide? Okay, the first two, three slides are just clippings from newspapers and magazines. Now, these are actual incidents that took place in India and abroad. These are not figment of anybody's imagination. They were reported in journals and newspapers. Now, if you look at the first one, I have titled it Humans or Bees. It says, it was not a scene out of a most brutal movie. It was a savage act that only medieval men could have played. 40 men behaved worse than bees, dragging a 16-year-old girl, Gudan Sharma, in broad daylight along the main road of a big town. Led by Sham Preet Chauhan, who was 25 years old, they rained kicks and punches on her. Passers-by, deaf to the girl's cries for help, stared at the sadistic march. This was reported in the Week magazine some time ago. Now, what was this young girl's fault that she was treated like this? But Sham Preet Chauhan made some advances towards her. She refused him, she rejected him. His ego was hurt, and so he collected about 35, 40 friends of his, and the 40 of them went to her house in broad daylight, pulled her by her hair, stripped her naked, and dragged her through the streets of that town in broad daylight. And not a soul did anything about it. They were just watching the sadistic march, and as they were dragging her, they kicked her and beat her up. The desperate father, because he couldn't do anything against these 40 people, went to the nearby police station, which was just 1 kilometer away, and tried to get them in. They refused to come initially because the Sham Preet Chauhan was the son of the local politician. So the police, the cops did nothing about it. By the time they came, these 40 people had let her go. She rushed home, poured kerosene over herself, and set herself on fire and died. That, ladies and gentlemen, was one incident that was reported in the magazine. Now, if you're thinking that these incidents take place only in a country like India, we are mistaken, because I think where people are involved, such things happen, I think, all over the world. This incident took place in UK. A couple were jailed for torturing and murdering an 8-year-old girl in one of Britain's worst cases of child cruelty. Anna Climby's half-starved body had 128 injuries inflicted by her great-aunt, Marie Teresa Kua, 44, and her boyfriend, 28 years old, Carl Manning. Neither showed any emotion. Now, that's the important part. As the guilty verdicts to murder were announced, Manning had already admitted to manslaughter and cruelty. The jury found Kua guilty of cruelty. The court heard that Anna had been beaten with a bicycle chain, scalded with boiling water, and burned with cigarettes. She had been whipped with a belt, which covered her body in buckle marks, and attacked her with a hammer, a razor blade, and a metal coat hanger. Anna was forced to eat like a dog with her hands bound as she lay in a path. She was dressed only in a bin bag. During freezing winter nights in the unheated bathroom, and the bag was tied up around her neck to catch her excrement. Anna had not been fed for 2 days, and she had not spoken for 24 hours before she died. This was reported in the Indian Express newspaper. So what I'm trying to ask you, ladies and gentlemen, is these are human beings. Why do we behave like this? Obviously, these are incidents which happen all over the world, but we are supposed to be human beings with the ability to think, the ability to emote, the ability to rationalize, and yet we behave like this towards fellow human beings. Mind you, animals don't behave like this towards their own kind. We human beings who are supposed to possess intelligence and emotions behave like this. Now, the slide that I've got here is a quotation from Aristotle, who thousands of years ago told us, anyone can become angry, that is easy. But to be angry with the right person, to the right degree, at the right time, for the right purpose, and in the right way, that is not easy. I've taken anger as an emotion just to illustrate this subject of emotional intelligence, because it is easy for us to understand, because I think all of us have felt angry at one time or other and behaved in different ways. Now, what Aristotle is telling us is, being angry by itself is not negative. We have a right to be angry, we are human beings, we will be angry. But to be angry at the right time, at the right place, to the right person, and express it appropriately, that is the challenge for us, ladies and gentlemen. Now, the problem, therefore, as Aristotle told us thousands of years ago, is not with emotionality. Emotions are natural. All of us experience different emotions. But with the appropriateness of emotion and its expression. I'm attempting a definition of emotional intelligence. Let me read this definition, and then I'll give you what I think would be perhaps a layman's understanding of emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence, Daniel Goleman is an author who has brought emotional intelligence to all of us in a very friendly manner. He has brought that topic and that subject to us. He has written innumerable books. He did not discover emotional intelligence. That was done decades before Daniel Goleman. But what he has done is presented emotional intelligence to us in a very friendly manner, in a way which we can understand and relate to. What he says is, it is the capacity for recognizing our own feelings and those of others, for motivating ourselves, and for managing emotions well in ourselves and in our relationships. Let me try to simplify this to an extent. You know, if I were to try to describe emotional intelligence to all of you, the way I would do it is, if I'm interacting, for example, with Sashi, in my interaction with Sashi, am I sensitive to her emotions? Am I aware of the fact that her feelings and emotions would influence her behavior? Am I also aware of my own feelings and how they influence my behavior? It's important that that degree of both self-awareness and emotional awareness exists in me. If I can be sensitive to Sashi's feelings and how they impact her behavior, and aware of my own feelings and how they are impacting my behavior, I can then carry on a productive interaction with Sashi. So, in other words, the term emotional intelligence actually seems a contradiction in terms, because we don't associate intelligence with emotions, nor do we think of emotions as being intelligent. So here we are suddenly talking about emotional intelligence. How can emotions be intelligent? And how can intelligence be related to emotions? What we are trying to say here, ladies and gentlemen, is that the ability to manage our emotions with intelligence would be a simple way of describing emotional intelligence. Actually, Daniel Goleman in one of his articles also says that another simpler, more often used word for emotional intelligence is maturity. And the good news is for all of us, emotional intelligence or EQ, emotional quotient, unlike IQ, can be developed, learned, and continuously improved by us. IQ, on the other hand, once we have reached a certain stage, we are not in a position to improve on IQ. EQ can be learned, which is why we say when it comes to EQ or EI, there is the influence of nature and nurturing. So now, apart from Daniel Goleman, we have other people like Cooper and Savaf who have given us definitions. I'm not going into that, but let me spend a couple of minutes on IQ and EQ, because the question that often comes up is IQ more important or EQ? Later, when we are discussing the subject of leadership, I'll be telling you about some research findings. But at this stage, let me just say, IQ by itself is not adequate. IQ and EQ are complementary. We are not discounting the value of IQ. All we are saying at this stage is they are complementary. And high IQ and low EQ will not help us as leaders. Leaders who have succeeded over a period of time are people who have a high level of IQ and a very high level of EQ. Consistently, research has established this. Now, in fact, as I have said in the slide, research indicates, research indicates that IQ accounts for job success in only about 10% of the cases. Okay. Now, I'm just going to spend a few minutes on the kinds of intelligence we have. I know many of you would be familiar with the work of Howard Gardner, who has talked about multiple intelligence. But at this stage, I'm just going to talk about emotional intelligence and IQ. EI skills are synergistic with cognitive ones, but the intellectual and emotional aspects express activities of different parts of the brain. This is not a biology class, but I just want to spend some time on this to be able to understand where our emotions flow from. And, you know, the belief that our mind and heart, intellect and emotions, they are watertight compartments is a myth. You cannot have that kind of a situation. Let's just move forward and I'll tell you. Okay, some basics at this stage. Is EI just being nice? No, the answer is no. When it comes to disciplining people, when it comes to correcting people, we have to do that. We have to be assertive. Remember, assertive, not aggressive. Emotionally intelligent people are never aggressive, but they are always assertive. And there is a key difference, which I'm sure all of you are aware of. Does EI mean just giving free rein to my feelings? Obviously not. Let's go back to Aristotle and remember what he said. Express your emotions appropriately. And is EI gender specific? I'm sure the women in the group would like to feel that women are perhaps more emotionally intelligent than men. Actually, I'm sorry to say there is no research to validate this. So there's no research to establish that women are more emotionally intelligent than men. I think it differs from individual to individual. And is EQ fixed genetically, like IQ? The answer is no. I said that earlier. And it is something that can be learned and developed. Okay? Yeah. Now, this is where the biology class starts. You know, the brain stem in the human beings was the first part of the brain that was developed thousands of years ago. That's the brain stem leads to the spinal cord, so that's at the back of our head. And from the brain stem, thousands of years later, two organs were formed. They are called amygdalas. Amygdala is the Greek word for almond because these two organs are almond-shaped. Now, the amygdala is a specialist for emotional matters. They are kind of a repository of all our emotions over the years. So, when we react from a purely emotional standpoint, then we are behaving from our amygdala. It's an amygdala reaction. Now, mercifully, all of us have another part of our brain, which is the thinking brain or the neocortex. Now, the neocortex was...
Sorry, Doctor, I'm interrupting you.
Sorry?
We started with 5 minutes for the presentation.
5 minutes. Oh, we have only 5 minutes more. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
I need to really rush through this. Okay. Let me then, can you go to the link? Let me see. I just want to show you the link. Okay. Those were pictures I have of the amygdala and the neocortex. I don't think we can go through all that. Let's move forward. Basically, what we are saying is the neocortex, which is the thinking part of the brain, when we encounter a situation, the message goes to the neocortex first, which helps us behave rationally. And then, about a split second later, it goes to the amygdalas. But by then, the neocortex takes charge and tells us, look, Swami, you can manage the situation, there's no need for you to get emotional or angry. So that's how we behave rationally most of the time. And we behave with the help of our neocortex. When I talk about emotional intelligence, we must remember that there is another aspect to it, which are the emotional competencies. There are many emotional competencies that are important for us to become emotionally intelligent. But I have listed here just 12 of them. Next. You can see the table there. I have got, I'm starting with self-awareness and then moving on to self-management, social awareness, and then social skills. In other words, when I talk about emotional intelligence, and in order to become emotionally intelligent, we must first possess a very high level of self-awareness and then be able to manage ourselves. The third stage is when I'm also sensitive to and aware of others and their feelings, and then the ability to manage others. So together, when I develop these skills, that is when I develop my emotional intelligence. Ideally, time permitting, I would take you through some of these aspects, but we don't have the time. So what I'm going to do now is to look at leadership and then connect the two, emotional intelligence and leadership. As I said, research has established that EI is a sine qua non of leadership. It's a non-negotiable requirement, absolutely essential. And as part of this research, competency models of about 188 companies were examined. In fact, over 350 senior executives of these companies were interviewed, and it was established that successful leaders over a long term possessed technical skills, cognitive skills, and EI competencies. EI competencies and not just IQ. It was established without any doubt that leaders or senior executives who possessed a very high level of EQ along with a high level of IQ were the ones who could endure as leaders. Now, the dictionary meaning of leadership I've given you there, guide someone or something on a way, etc., etc. I'm not going to go through this because Sashi has told us we have just 5 minutes. Let's move forward. But at the end of the day, leadership is really an inside job. Leadership is above all from within. As Leo Tolstoy told us, everyone thinks of changing the world, but no one thinks of changing himself. I would just like to spend a minute on this slide because I think I've tried to capture here the essentials of leadership. Leadership has 4 distinct verticals. We have intrapersonal leadership, interpersonal leadership, managerial leadership, and organizational leadership. Now, if you look at the left part of this circle, I'm referring to it as building character and living by principles. That, I believe, is essential for leadership. The right-hand side of this circle is about developing personality and learning skills. They are important. But if I don't have the first part, I will not be able to succeed as a leader with just the skills of management. Next. Just to define leadership very quickly, I feel it is a process whereby an individual influences a group of individuals to achieve a common goal, which is in consonance with universal values and principles. I'm making a slight departure here from the customary definition of leadership, which is just to influence others towards achievement of certain agreed organizational goals. What I'm adding to that is those goals must be in consonance with universal values and principles. I'm saying this because that's what makes a difference between a Hitler on the one hand as a leader and a Gandhiji as a leader. They are both considered to be leaders, but what marks Gandhiji is that his goals were in consonance with values and principles. Now, let's move forward. Sashi, I'm sorry, I think I'm exceeding the time limit. I'll take just about another 3 minutes or so.
No problem, Doctor. We are receiving so many requests from our live attendees that they want to exceed the session for next 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you. Then I'm not going into the definition of leadership and leadership styles. I'll just confine it to what is now talked about as transactional leadership and transformational leadership. Transactional leadership is a kind of leadership that is normally practiced. Essentially, they are managers. I'm not discounting the value of managership, very important. But what we need in any organization or country is transformational leadership. And let's talk about transformational leadership. Transactional leadership, as I said, is a kind of leadership which managers practice, teachers, managers, politicians practice. But let's look at transformational leadership. It is the process that changes and transforms individuals. It is concerned with principles, values, emotions, and standards, and involves assessing followers' emotions and motives. Such leaders are sensitive to the feelings of the followers. They, essentially, transformational leaders possess a very high level of self-awareness and emotional intelligence. They empower their followers and nurture them to change and realize their potential. They are very strong role models. And they also live by principles and values. They do the right thing. I think we are all aware of what Peter Drucker told us many years ago. Leaders do the right thing. Managers do things right. So when transformational leaders are people who do things right at all times, even if it is at their own personal cost, and they create a vision, transformational leadership leaders, they have a compelling vision for their own life and their values. They have the capacity to dream and also the ability to translate those dreams and images so that followers are inspired by their visions. Now, I've just given the vision statements of some giant leaders. Winston Churchill's, I'm sure all of us would have heard this, about how he spoke when Hitler was on his, he was attacking and trying to conquer the world. So he talked about, Churchill talked about the abyss of a new dark age if Hitler were to succeed. And then I would like to move on. I don't want to dwell on Winston Churchill. He talked about the finest hour, Britain's finest hours. I'm sure we are familiar with it. I want to spend a minute or so on Martin Luther King's very famous speech of I Have a Dream. Now, you remember this, and it's something worth watching on YouTube. He talked about the dream that he has for the world, for America and the world. He said, finally, in the next slide, he says, I have a dream that my four children will one day live in a nation where they will be judged not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. And the speech goes on, I have a dream speech. But it's very significant that many years, decades later, we have a black man as the president of the US today. I think Obama's speech in Chicago when he got elected is something which I'm not going to show it to you. It's something worth watching. Now, yeah. So these are the kind of compelling, forceful visions and dreams that transformational leadership is all about. Transformational leaders are those leaders who demonstrate a very high level of emotional intelligence. Ultimately, transformational leaders possess very high EI. They raise themselves to a higher plane of awareness, realization, and existence. They manage their own emotions and the emotions of others effectively so as to make their transactions with them more productive. They enable others to raise themselves similarly to a higher level of consciousness. That, ladies and gentlemen, is why I wanted to emphasize how critical EI is for enduring leadership. It's important for all of us, emotional intelligence, but especially for leaders. We cannot have a leader who is not aware of himself, who is not aware and sensitive to his own feelings and the feelings of others, who cannot be empathetic. I would take you back to the slide that table where it starts with, can you go back? You can't do anything with it. Can you go back to the third or fourth slide? Yeah, go back. The slide where I come down, that table. This slide, I'll just point out to you, it starts with self-awareness. So, and leadership is the last part of the slide table. So you can't have a leader if he is not aware of himself. So if you look at this table, ladies and gentlemen, you see that there is a certain sequence to it. There is a certain hierarchy to this. You can't be a leader if you're not aware of yourself and your emotions. You can't be a leader if you don't have empathy, if you can't practice empathy. And if you want to manage teams, you've got to be empathetic. And if you want to manage conflict, you have to be assertive and empathetic. Which is why leadership is about emotional intelligence, or put it differently, emotional intelligence is really the sine qua non for leaders. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This has been a rush job, but that's all the time we had. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Swami, for presenting this wonderful session and sharing your insights. We are already receiving a very good response from our participants. And we have started receiving multiple questions from our attendees. So we just, as time is not much left, so we'll just take few questions and then we'll wrap up today's show. First question coming up is by Sati, and her question is, what activities can we use to introduce emotional intelligence for lower and middle management?
What activities can be introduced for lower and middle management?
See, what we can do, Sashi, is as an organization, we need to start first with a training program for middle and junior management on what is emotional intelligence. Now, a program on this subject would really take them through this table that is there on the screen, you know, where we talk about self-awareness, self-management, etc. Now, we need to make our participants aware of what is emotional intelligence and how we can become emotionally intelligent. We need to know what is self-awareness, be aware, be able to assess our own level of self-awareness and see where we need to move and how we need to move forward. And as we are discussing, the participants in this kind of a workshop would be enabled to assess their own self-awareness, their own level of empathy, their ability to manage conflicts, their ability to manage change, etc. So it needs to start there, creating awareness in individuals about what is emotional intelligence and how we can become emotionally intelligent. At an organizational level, the leaders would need to demonstrate through their own behavior that they are emotionally intelligent human beings. That is my response to your question, Sashi.
Thank you so much, Doctor, for answering Sati's question. So we have multiple questions, but because of time, we'll be able to take only the last question. And
yes.
This question is by Abhishek, and his question is, most of the time, transactional leaders are considered to be transformational leaders as they promote people. How do we change this mindset?
Let me clarify. Your question is, how can transactional leaders become transformational leaders? Is that your question?
So my question is that transactional leaders are considered to be transformational leaders because they promote people.
No.
So
transactional leaders... Sorry, carry on.
This is people's mindset is that transaction leaders are considered are transformation leaders because they promote people. So how can we change this mindset?
No, transactional leaders are not transformational leaders. There is a lot of difference between the transactional leader and the transformational leader. The transactional leader's focus is on achieving the goals, not on development of people, but achieving goals. You know, in a way, it is essentially the difference between a manager and a leader. So when we look at what the manager does, and what a leader does, you realize the difference between a transactional leader and a transformational leader. Not just achieving targets. I'm not discounting the value, I repeat. It's important. Managers are important. Transactional leaders are important. But to take the organization to the future on a growth path, what we need are transformational leaders, not just achieving targets and numbers for today, but for 5 years from now, for 10 years from now, and in the process also enabling and empowering their people. That is what transformational leaders do. And I think we need to sensitize people, our people, to the difference between these two.
Thank you so much, Doctor, for answering Abhishek's question. I hope Abhishek has better clarity now on transactional leaders and transformational leaders. And with this question and answer session, we are going to wrap up today's Masterclass session. Once again, I want to thank today's Masterclass partners, Center for Creative Leadership, TSN Talent Health, Computer Systems of Skills of Company, Great Lakes Institute of Management, and Wilson Learning. Finally, a special thanks to Dr. Swami, speaker for this Masterclass, for the time and invaluable information he has shared with us today. And I would like to thank everybody in the Masterclass audience for participating in today's presentation. We will come back to you with many more. That concludes today's webcast. Thank you and have a good day.
Thank you, Sashi, for all the arrangements and the follow-up. Thank you very much. I enjoyed this interaction. Thank you.